Goldilocks and the Three Bears.
Once upon a time, there was a cottage in the woods where three bears lived. There was a great big daddy bear, a middle-sized mummy bear, and a teeny-weeny baby bear. Daddy Bear had a very big bowl to eat from, a very big chair to sit on, and a very big bed to sleep in. Mummy Bear had a middle-sized bowl to eat from, a middle-sized chair to sit on, and a middle-sized bed to sleep in. And Baby Bear had a teeny-weeny bowl to eat from, a teeny-weeny chair to sit on, and a teeny-weeny bed to sleep in. One day, Mummy Bear cooked them all porridge for breakfast. She served the porridge into their bowls, but they couldn't eat it because it was too hot. So while it cooled down, they decided to go for a walk. Goldilocks was a pretty girl who had long blonde hair. That is why everyone called her Goldilocks. One day, she went for a walk. Her mother told her not to go into the forest alone, otherwise she would get lost. But Goldilocks never listened to her mother. After walking for a while, Goldilocks suddenly found that she was indeed lost. Tired and hungry, she walked some more until finally she came across the Three Bears' cottage. She knocked on the door, but when no one answered, she decided to have a look inside. When she got inside the cottage, she found three bowls of porridge. Goldilocks tried the porridge in the biggest bowl. "Ouch!" she said. "This porridge is too hot!" So she tried the porridge in the medium-sized bowl. "Eh!" she said. "This porridge is too cold!" So she tried the porridge in the teeny-weeny bowl. She said. "This porridge is just right." So she ate it all up. After eating the porridge, Goldilocks wanted to sit down. She looked around and found three chairs. First, she tried the biggest chair. "Oh dear," she said. "This chair is much too big." Then she tried the medium-sized chair. "Oh no," she said. "This chair is still too big." Finally, she tried the teeny-weeny chair. "This chair is just right," she said. So she sat on it, but then the chair broke into pieces. Goldilocks became sleepy and decided to look upstairs. She found a room with three beds. She tried the biggest bed. "Ouch!" she said. "This bed is too hard!" So she tried the medium-sized bed. "Oh no! This bed is too soft!" So she tried the teeny-weeny bed. "This bed is just right!" And it was so comfortable that she lay down on it and fell asleep. Meanwhile, the three bears came home from their walk ready to eat their food.
"Who's been eating my porridge?" said Daddy Bear.
"Who's been eating my porridge?" said Mummy Bear.
"Who's been eating my porridge?" said Little Baby Bear. "And look, they've eaten it all up!"
Then the three bears saw their chairs.
"Who's been sitting in my chair?" said Daddy Bear.
"Who's been sitting in my chair?" said Mummy Bear.
"Who's been sitting in my chair?" said Little Baby Bear. "And they've broken it!"
The three bears went to look upstairs.
Who's been sleeping in my bed?
Said Daddy Bear.
Who's been sleeping in my bed?
Said Mummy Bear.
Who's been sleeping in my bed?
Said Little Baby Bear.
And they're still here.
Just then, Goldilocks woke up. She saw the three bears and screamed. She jumped out of bed, ran down the stairs and out of the house as fast as she could. She ran and ran until finally she saw her house and her mother and promised her that she would never go into the forest by herself again. And that was the last the three bears ever saw of Goldilocks. The end.
The Frog Prince.
One night, a young princess was out walking when she came across a large pond. Sitting down for a rest, she took a golden ball from her pocket and threw it into the air and caught it. This she did again and again, but one time she threw the ball so high that when it came down she wasn't able to catch it. The ball bounced away until it fell right into the pond. Upset she had lost her favourite thing in the world, the princess started to cry, when just then a frog popped its head out of the water and said,
"Why are you crying?"
Slightly surprised to see a talking frog, the princess replied, "My golden ball has fallen into the pond. If you help me get it back, I will give you all my clothes and jewellery." The frog looked at the princess and replied,
"I don't want your jewels and fine clothes, but if you promise to let me eat from your golden plate and sleep on your bed, I will get your ball for you."
What nonsense, thought the princess. But if he can get my ball, then I will tell him he can have whatever he wants. So she agreed to the deal, and the frog gave a smile before diving under the water. After a little while, he came up again with the ball in his mouth and threw it to the princess. The princess jumped up, happy to have the ball in her hands again, and never gave another thought to the frog as she ran home with it as fast as she could. The frog called after her,
"Hey, take me with you!"
But she didn't stop and disappeared into the night. The next day, just as the princess had sat down to dinner, she heard a strange noise. Tap, tap, plash, plash, and then there was a gentle knock at the door, as a little voice cried out,
"Open the door, my princess dear. Open the door to my true love here, and remember the words that you and I said. A promise is a promise. I want to be fed."
The princess ran to the door and opened it to see the frog sitting there. Instantly, she remembered her promise and didn't know what to do. So, in a panic, she slammed the door shut again and ran back inside. Her father, the king, asked what the matter was. She told him about what happened the previous night and said she didn't know what to do. The king, who was very wise, replied,
"As you have made a promise, you must keep it. So go and let him in."
This she did, and the frog hopped into the room and onto the table where the princess was sitting. The frog then said,
"Please put your plate nearer to me so I can eat from it."
Which she did. And when he had eaten as much as he could, he said,
"Now I am tired. Carry me upstairs and put me on your bed."
The princess reluctantly took him into her hands and put him on the pillow of her bed, where he slept all night. As soon as it was morning, he jumped up, hopped downstairs, and left the house. Now then, thought the princess, at last he is gone, and I shall not be bothered by him any more. But she was wrong, as the next night she heard the same tapping at the door, and the frog came once more and said,
"Open the door, my princess dear. Open the door to my true love here, and remember the words that you and I said. A promise is a promise. I want to be fed."
When the princess opened the door, the frog came in, ate her food, and slept on her pillow just as before, until the morning when he left. And the third night he did exactly the same thing. But when the princess awoke the following morning, she was amazed to see that instead of the frog, a handsome prince was standing at the end of her bed. He told her that he had been cursed by a wicked fairy who had changed him into a frog, and that he had been forced to live as a frog until a princess would take him out of the pond and let him eat from her plate and sleep on her bed for 3 nights.
"You,"
said the prince,
"have broken the spell, and now all I wish for is that we can marry, and I will love you for the rest of your life."
The young princess was the happiest girl in the world and said yes straight away, and as the prince said, they lived happily ever after. The end. The Ugly Duckling.
Once upon a time, there was an old farm. And on that farm lived a family of ducks. Mother Duck had been sitting on a clutch of new eggs for weeks. Until finally, one morning, the eggs hatched open and out popped 6 chirpy ducklings, all crying, "Peep, peep!" But one egg was bigger than the rest, and it didn't hatch like all the others.
"Oh dear,"
Mother Duck said to herself.
"I'm so tired of sitting on eggs. I wonder how much longer this one is going to take to hatch."
But being a good mother, she sat on the nest again and continued to wait. And wait. And wait a bit longer. Until finally, the big egg cracked and broke open. Slowly, out came 2 big feet and a head. But it wasn't a soft little yellow head like the other ducklings. This one was big and grey with a long, scrawny neck and a fuzzy body.
"My, my,"
said Mother Duck when she saw him.
"He certainly doesn't look like any of my other children. I wonder how he got to look so different."
"He's ugly," quacked the other ducklings. "He doesn't look a bit like us, and we don't want to play with him."
"Now, now,"
said Mother Duck.
"He's your brother, and you will be nice to him."
But the other ducklings did not want to have anything to do with him, and ran away to play by themselves. Well, the grey duckling certainly wasn't pretty. And since he ate far more than his brothers, he was getting bigger than them very quickly. As the days went by, the poor ugly duckling became more and more unhappy. His brothers didn't want to play with him. He was so clumsy, and all the farmyard animals simply laughed at him wherever he went. He felt very sad and lonely. Mother Duck did her best to comfort him, but it was no use.
"Poor little ugly duckling,"
she would say.
"Why are you so different from all the others?"
But this just made the ugly duckling feel worse than ever. Every night, he cried himself to sleep. He felt that nobody wanted him.
"Nobody loves me. They all tease me.
Why am I different from my brothers? One day, the weather was lovely and the sun shone brightly in the sky. So Mother Duck took her young family down to the water for a swimming lesson. She jumped in with a splash.
Quack, quack,
she cried. As one after the other, the little ducklings jumped in. Under the water, they all disappeared. But quickly, each one came up and swam about quite prettily. The ugly duckling had also followed them down to the pond.
I'll bet that ugly grey brother of ours can't swim, shouted one of the little yellow ducklings.
Seeing all the other ducklings swimming about, he jumped into the water and had a go himself. Under the water he went with a big splash, until suddenly he reappeared and started to swim. In fact, much better than most of his brothers.
Oh my word,
said Mother Duck.
He certainly can swim. He must be my own child after all.
But as the days went by, the poor ugly duckling became more and more unhappy. His brothers still didn't want to play with him because he was so big and different. He felt sad and lonely, and while Mother Duck did her best to comfort him, the ugly duckling felt worse than ever. Nobody loves me, he said. They all tease me. Why am I different from my brothers? One day, the ugly duckling decided that he could take no more teasing. And at sunrise, he ran away from the farmyard. He stopped at a pond and began to question all the other birds he could find.
Do you know of any ducklings with grey feathers like mine? He asked.
But everyone shook their heads.
We don't know anyone as ugly as you,
the other birds said. But the ugly duckling did not lose heart and kept on asking all the other birds. He went to another pond, where a pair of large geese gave him the same answer to his question. What's more, they warned him.
Don't stay here. Go away, quick. It's dangerous. There are men with guns.
Just then, he heard the bang, bang of a gun and ran for his life. The duckling was sorry he had ever left the farmyard. After walking some more, it started to rain. And at last he came to a miserable little shack that only seemed to remain standing because it didn't know which way to tumble down. The door hung open crookedly, and the duckling slipped inside to get out of the rain. Inside, he found a corner to rest in and fell asleep for the night. In the morning, he woke to find an old woman lived there with her cat and her hen. They saw the duckling and decided to allow him to stay with them as long as he lay eggs to sell. However, the duckling could not do this, and the cat and the hen made fun of him whenever the old woman was not looking. The hen said to the ugly duckling,
If you don't lay eggs, the old woman will wring your neck and pop you into the pot.
And the cat chipped in.
Hee hee, I hope the old woman cooks you. Then I can eat your bones.
The poor ugly duckling was so scared that he lost his appetite. Though the old woman kept stuffing him with food and grumbling,
If you won't lay eggs to sell, at least hurry up and get fat so I can make you into a nice meal.
So one night, he decided it was time to leave. And he quietly escaped from the miserable little shack. Once again, he was all alone. He fled as far away as he could. And at daybreak, he found himself in a thick bed of reeds by the water.
If nobody wants me, I'll hide here forever.
There was plenty of food, and the duckling began to feel a little happier, although he was still very lonely. Then one day, at sunrise, he saw some beautiful birds fly overhead. They were white, with long, slender necks, yellow beaks, and large wings.
Oh, if only I could look like them. Just for a day, said the duckling.
Winter came, and the water in the reed bed froze over. The poor duckling left home to seek food in the snow, but it was very tiring, and he could not find anything to eat. Finally, he was so exhausted he dropped to the ground. But luckily, a farmer found him and put him in his big jacket pocket.
I'll take him home to my children. They'll look after him. Poor thing, he's frozen.
The duckling was showered with kindly care at the farmer's house, and because of this kindness, the ugly duckling was able to live through the very cold winter. By springtime, he had grown so big that the farmer decided to set him free by the pond. Outside, the weather was warm and sunny, and birds sang as flowers bloomed. Suddenly, the duckling found that he could flap his wings and fly. He took to the air and looked for somewhere to call home. In no time at all, he found himself in a beautiful garden, when from nowhere, three glorious white birds appeared. They were the same white birds he had seen fly off to warmer homes just before the winter. They were called swans, and as they appeared, they ruffled their feathers as they swam lightly across the water. The ugly duckling was amazed at the beautiful birds and thought to himself, "If I dare go near them, they will laugh at me because I am so ugly. But I don't care. Better to be laughed at by these beautiful creatures than to be teased by ducks and hens, or kicked by children, or starve in the winter." So he dived into the water and swam out to the swans.
"Laugh at me," cried the poor creature, bending his head down to the water. But what was this he saw reflected in the clear water? It was his own image. For the first time, he saw himself as he really was. And, to his utter amazement, he saw that he was not an ugly duckling anymore, or a duckling at all, but a swan, a beautiful white swan. The other swans recognized him as one of their own and didn't chase him away. Instead, they caressed him gently with their beaks. And for the first time in his life, he knew what it was like to love and be loved. The end.
Rumpelstiltskin.
Once upon a time, there was a poor miller who had a very beautiful daughter. One day, he had an audience with the king, and in order to impress him, he told the king that he had a daughter who could spin straw into gold.
"Now that's a talent worth having,"
said the king.
"If your daughter is as clever as you say, bring her to my palace tomorrow and I'll test her to see if she really can spin straw into gold."
The next day, when the girl was taken to the king, he led her into a room full of straw, gave her a spinning wheel and spindle and said,
"Now, start to work and spin all night until the morning. And if by then you haven't spun all the straw into gold, you will have to leave the city."
He then closed the door behind him and left her alone inside. The poor miller's daughter sat down and didn't know what she was going to do. She hadn't any idea of how to spin straw into gold and became so upset at the thought of having to leave the city, she began to cry. Suddenly, the door opened and in stepped a tiny little man who said,
"Good evening. Why are you crying so much?"
"Oh," answered the girl, "I have to spin all this straw into gold and I don't know how to do it."
"What will you give me if I spin it for you?"
asked the little man. "How about my necklace?" replied the girl. The little man took the necklace, sat himself down at the wheel, and whir, 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 the wheel went round 3 times, and the bobbin was full. Then he put on another, and whir, 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 the wheel went round 3 times, and the second was full too. And so it went on until the morning, when all the straw was spun away, and all the bobbins were full of gold. As soon as the sun rose, the king came to see the result of his test, and when he saw the gold, he was astonished and delighted. But his heart only lusted for more of the precious metal. He had the miller's daughter put into another room full of straw, much bigger than the first, and said to her that if she wanted to stay in the city, she must spin it all into gold before the morning. The girl didn't know what to do and began to cry again. And then the door opened as before, and the tiny little man appeared and said,
"What will you give me if I spin the straw into gold for you?"
"How about the ring from my finger?" answered the girl. The little man took the ring, and whir, whir, whir. Round went the spinning wheel again, and when morning came, he had spun all the straw into glittering gold. The king was even more pleased than the previous day at the sight of all the gold, but his greed was still not satisfied, and he had the miller's daughter brought into a yet bigger room full of straw and said,
"You must spin all this into gold through the night, but if you succeed this time, you shall become my wife."
When the girl was alone once more, the little man appeared for the 3rd time and said,
"What will you give me if I spin the straw for you again?"
"I've nothing more to give," answered the girl.
"Then promise me, when you are queen, to give me your first child."
"Who knows if that will ever happen?" thought the miller's daughter. And besides, she saw no other way out of it. So she promised the little man what he demanded, and he set to work once more and spun the straw into gold. When the king came in the morning and found everything as he had desired, he straightway made her his wife, and the miller's daughter became a queen. When a year had passed, a beautiful son was born to her, and she thought no more of the little man, until one day he stepped into her room and said,
"Now, give me what you promised."
The queen was very upset by this and offered the little man all the riches in her kingdom if he would leave her the child. But the little man said,
No, a living creature is dearer to me than all the treasures in the world.
The queen began to cry and sob so bitterly that the little man felt sorry for her and said,
I'll give you 3 days to guess my name. And if you find it out in that time, you may keep your child.
The queen debated the whole night over all the names she had ever heard and sent a messenger to search the land and to pick up any unusual names he could come across. When the little man arrived the following day, she began with Ben, William, David, and all the names she knew. But at each one, the little man called out,
That's not my name.
The next day, she sent someone to ask all the names of the people in the neighbourhood and had a long list of the most uncommon and extraordinary ones for the little man when he made his appearance. Is your name perhaps Sheepshanks, Crookshanks, Spindleshanks? But he always replied,
That's not my name.
On the third day, the messenger returned and announced,
I have not been able to find any new names, but as I came across a high hill around the corner of the wood, I saw a little house, and in front of the house was a fire, and around the fire danced the most grotesque little man, hopping on one leg and crying,
Tomorrow I brew, today I bake, and then the child away I'll take, for little deems my royal dame that Rumpelstiltskin is my name.
You can imagine the queen's delight at hearing the name, and when the little man stepped in shortly afterwards and asked,
Now, my lady queen, what's my name?
Is your name Conrad?
No.
Is your name Harry?
No.
Is your name perhaps Rumpelstiltskin?
Some demon has told you that,
screamed the little man. And in his rage, drove his right foot so far into the ground that it sank up to his waist. Then, in a rage, he seized his left foot and did the same. And as he was screaming, the earth almost appeared to open up, and Rumpelstiltskin disappeared into the ground and was never seen again. The End. Rapunzel.
Once upon a time, there was a man and his wife who lived in a house. And at the back of their house was a window which looked into the most lovely garden you have ever seen. But they could not go into the garden because it belonged to a wicked old witch. One day, the woman stood at the window and saw some of the finest, sweet-tasting herb called Rapunzel. Every day she looked at the Rapunzel and wanted it more and more. Her husband could see his wife was sad and asked her what the matter was. She said,
If I don't get some Rapunzel to eat, I know I will die.
The man, who loved his wife very much, thought to himself, I have to get her some Rapunzel, no matter what the cost. So that night, he sneaked into the witch's garden and quickly gathered some Rapunzel leaves. He took them home and his wife made a salad with them, which tasted so good she wanted even more. The next night, her husband went back into the garden, but this time, when he got there, he froze with fear, as standing before him was the old witch.
How dare you come into my garden and steal my Rapunzel?
She said.
You shall suffer for what you have done.
I'm so sorry, said the man, but I had to take the Rapunzel. My wife wanted it so badly, she was sure she would die if her wish had not been granted. The witch's anger eased a little as she replied,
If this is true, you can take as much Rapunzel as you like, but on one condition. You give me the child your wife will shortly have."
The man, in his fear, agreed and quickly ran home. A few months later, a child was born, and the witch appeared to collect the baby. She gave it the name Rapunzel after the sweet herb and took her away. Rapunzel was the most beautiful child, but the witch wanted her all to herself. So when she was 12, she locked her up in a tower in the middle of a great wood. The tower had no stairs or doors, and only a small window at the very top. When the witch wanted to get in, she stood underneath the tower and called out,
"Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your golden hair."
Now Rapunzel had wonderful long hair, and whenever she heard the witch's voice, she untied her plaits and let her hair fall down out of the window so the witch could climb up it. They lived like this for a few years, until one day a prince was riding nearby. He heard someone singing so sweetly, he stood still, spellbound, and listened. It was Rapunzel, in her loneliness, trying to pass away the time. The prince wanted to see the owner of the voice, but even though he looked in vain for a door to the tower, he could not see a way in. He rode home, but was so haunted by the song, he returned every day to listen to her voice. One day, when he was standing behind a tree, he saw the witch approach and heard her call out,
"Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your golden hair."
Rapunzel let down her plaits and the witch climbed up them. "So that's the staircase," said the prince. "Then I too will climb up and try my luck." The following day, he went to the foot of the tower and cried, "Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your golden hair." And as soon as Rapunzel had let her hair down, the prince climbed up. At first, Rapunzel was frightened when a man appeared, as she had never seen one before. But the prince spoke to her so kindly that very soon she lost all her fear. After several visits, the prince asked Rapunzel to marry him, and she said yes at once.
"But first, I have to get out of the tower."
Quickly, she had an idea.
"Every time you come to see me, you must bring a piece of silk. I will then make a ladder out of them, and when it's finished, I will climb down and you can take me away on your horse."
The old witch knew nothing of what was going on, until one day Rapunzel, not thinking of what she was saying, turned to the witch and said,
"How is it that you are so much harder to pull up than the young prince?" "Oh, you wicked child," cried the witch. "I thought I had hidden you from the whole world, but you have still managed to trick me."
In her anger, she grabbed Rapunzel's hair with one hand and, grasping a pair of scissors with the other, snip, snap, and off it came, leaving the beautiful plaits on the ground. And worse than this, she was so cold-hearted, she took Rapunzel to a lonely desert and left her there to live in misery by herself. In the evening, the witch fastened the plaits onto a hook by the window, and when the prince came and called out, "Rapunzel, Rapunzel, let down your golden hair," she threw them down for the prince to climb up. But instead of seeing his beloved Rapunzel, he found the old witch, who cried mockingly.
"Ha! You thought you would find your lady love here, but the pretty bird has flown and its song is silent. Rapunzel is lost to you forever, and you will never see her again."
The prince was so upset that in his despair he jumped down from the tower. Although he escaped with his life, his heart was broken in two. Full of sadness, he wandered through the woods, eating nothing but roots and berries, and weeping about the loss of his lovely bride. He wandered about for some years, sad and unhappy, until finally he came to the desert where Rapunzel was living. Just then, he heard a voice which seemed strangely familiar to him. He walked quickly towards the sound, and when he was quite close, he saw Rapunzel. The two of them ran to each other and cried with joy. After this, he led her to his kingdom, where they were married, and promised he would never leave her again, and they lived happily ever after. The end.
Jack and the Beanstalk.
Once upon a time, there was a poor widow who had a son named Jack and a cow named Milky White. They were so poor, all they had to live on was the milk from the cow. But one day, Milky White gave them no more milk, and they didn't know what to do.
"We have no money and no food,"
said Jack's mother.
"You will have to take Milky White to market and sell her."
So, off Jack went to the market to sell their only cow. He hadn't gone far when he met a funny-looking old man. "Good morning, Jack," said the man.
"Good morning to you," replied Jack,
as he wondered how the old man knew his name. "Where are you off to?" he asked.
"I'm going to the market to sell our cow."
The old man smiled and said, "Then I might be able to help you." Reaching into his pocket, he pulled out a number of strange-looking beans.
"What are they?" asked Jack.
"These are magic beans, and I will swap them for your cow."
"Magic beans?" said Jack. "What would I do with magic beans?"
"Ah, you don't know what these beans are," said the man. "If you plant them in your garden, by morning they will grow right up to the sky." Jack looked at the magic beans again and thought about what to do. After a minute, he had made up his mind.
"All right, I will sell you my cow," said Jack.
And he took the beans and gave the cow to the old man. Happy with the deal he had just done, Jack returned home to find his mother waiting for him.
"You sold the cow, I see. How much did you get for her?"
"I got something better than money," said Jack.
"What is better than money?"
his mother replied. Jack held out his hand and showed her the beans.
"Look, mother, these are magic beans. You plant them in your garden and..."
"What?"
screamed Jack's mother.
"You swapped our only cow for a few beans? How could you do such a thing?"
Full of anger, she grabbed the beans from Jack's hand and threw them into the garden, before sending the poor boy off to bed without any supper. The next morning, Jack woke up to find that his room was very dark. How strange, he thought, as he jumped out of bed to investigate. Looking out of the window, he could see that the beans his mother had thrown into the garden had grown into a giant beanstalk. It went up and up and up until it reached the clouds in the sky. Amazed, Jack opened his window, jumped onto the beanstalk, and began to climb. He climbed, and he climbed, and he climbed, until at last he reached the top, which was very high in the sky. When he put his head through the clouds, he saw a long, wide road with a great big house at the end of it. He walked along the road until finally he reached the house. Tired and hungry after his journey, he knocked on the door. And after a short wait, a very tall woman opened the door. "Good morning," said Jack. "Could you be so kind as to give me some breakfast?"
"It's breakfast you want, is it?"
said the very tall woman.
"It's breakfast you'll be if you don't move off from here. My husband is an ogre, and there's nothing he likes better than to eat little boys like you."
"Oh, please give me something to eat. I've had nothing since yesterday morning, and I am very hungry," said Jack. The ogre's wife had a kind heart and took pity on him. She led Jack into the kitchen and gave him some bread and cheese and a big jug of milk. But he hadn't finished eating when suddenly they heard thump, thump, thump. The whole house began to tremble with the noise of someone coming.
"Goodness gracious me, it's my husband,"
said the ogre's wife. "What on earth shall I do?"
"Quickly, get in here."
And with speed, she bundled him into the oven and shut the door just as the ogre came in. He certainly was big. With his nose sniffing the air, he said in a deep, loud voice,
"Fee, fi, fo, fum! I smell the blood of an Englishman! Be he alive or be he dead, I'll have his bones to grind my bread!"
"Nonsense, dear," said his wife. "You're dreaming. Now have a wash and tidy up, and by the time you come back, your breakfast will be ready."
So off the ogre went to get ready for breakfast. Once the ogre had gone, Jack opened the oven door and was ready to jump out and run away when the woman said,
"Stop! Wait until he is asleep. He always has a doze just after breakfast."
So Jack stayed quiet until the ogre had eaten his breakfast. As he waited, he watched the ogre reach into a big chest and pull out a couple of bags of gold. He began to count the gold. But quickly, the ogre became tired and started to snore, making the whole house shake. Jack quietly crept out of the oven, and as he was passing the ogre, he took one of the bags of gold under his arm. Quickly, he ran away until he came to the beanstalk. Dropping the bag of gold, it fell into his mother's garden. And then he climbed down the beanstalk until at last he was home. That night, he told his mother what had happened and showed her the gold.
"Well, mother, wasn't I right about the beans?" said Jack. "They really are magical."
His mother was very pleased, and they used the bag of gold to buy food for some time. But finally, they came to the end of it. And Jack made up his mind to try his luck once more at the top of the beanstalk. One fine morning, he woke up early, got onto the beanstalk, and he climbed, and he climbed, and he climbed, until at last he came to the road again. When he reached the house, sure enough, there was the very tall woman standing on the doorstep.
"Good morning," said Jack, as bold as brass. "Could you be so good as to give me something to eat?"
"Aren't you the young man who came here once before?"
said the woman.
Do you know, that very day my husband lost one of his bags of gold?
That's strange, said Jack. I dare say I could tell you something about that. But I'm so hungry, I can't speak until I've had something to eat. The very tall woman was so curious that she took him in and gave him something to eat. But he had scarcely begun munching when suddenly they heard the ogre's footsteps. Thump, thump, thump. Quickly, his wife hid Jack away in the oven again. Everything happened as it did before. In came the ogre, with his nose sniffing the air, as he said in his deep, booming voice,
Fee, fi, fo, fum! I smell the blood of an Englishman!
Rubbish,
said his wife, as he sat down to eat his breakfast. Once he had finished eating, the ogre said to his wife,
Bring me the hen that lays the golden eggs.
So she brought him the hen, and the ogre said,
Lay.
And it laid an egg made of gold. He said the magic word again, and the hen laid another golden egg. And another. And another. Until, after a while, the ogre became tired and fell asleep. He started to snore until the whole house shook again. Jack crept out of the oven on tiptoes, grabbed the golden hen, and was off again before you could say Jack Robinson. But the hen gave a cackle, which woke the ogre. And just as Jack was running out of the house, he heard the ogre calling,
Wife! Wife! What have you done with my golden hen?
But Jack was away. He rushed off towards the beanstalk and climbed down with the hen under his arm as quickly as he could. And when he got home, he showed his mother the wonderful hen and said to it, Lay! And it laid a golden egg each and every time he said the magic word. But Jack was not content, and it was not long before he decided to try his luck again up in the magical world at the top of the beanstalk. So one fine morning, he woke up early, got onto the beanstalk, and he climbed, and he climbed, and he climbed, until finally he reached the top. But this time, he knew better than to go straight to the ogre's house. So when he got near, he waited behind a bush until he saw the ogre's wife coming out with a bucket to get some water. When she was outside, he quietly crept inside the house and got into a big cauldron to hide. He hadn't been there long when he heard thump, thump, thump. And in came the ogre and his wife.
Fee, fi, fo, fum! I smell the blood of an Englishman!
Cried the ogre.
I smell him, wife! I smell him!
Do you, my dear?
Said the ogre's wife.
Then if it's that little rogue that stole your gold and the hen that lays the golden eggs, he's sure to have got into the oven.
And so they both rushed over to the oven to have a look. But luckily, Jack wasn't there, as the ogre's wife said,
There you are again with your fee-fi-fo-fum.
The ogre looked all around the kitchen, but could not find Jack anywhere. Thankfully, he did not look in the cauldron. So the ogre sat down for his breakfast and ate it all up. After he had finished eating, the ogre called out,
"Wife! Wife! Bring me my golden harp!"
So his wife brought out the golden harp and put it on the table before him.
Then he said, "Sing!"
And the golden harp began to sing the most beautiful song. And it went on singing until the ogre finally fell asleep and started to snore like thunder. Just then, Jack lifted up the lid of the cauldron very quietly and crept out like a mouse until he reached the table. Up he crawled, grabbed hold of the golden harp, and dashed with it towards the door. But as he ran, the harp called out quite loudly,
"Master! Master!"
And the ogre woke up just in time to see Jack running off with his harp. Jack ran as fast as he could as the ogre came rushing after him, but the giant was very quick. When he got to the beanstalk, the ogre was not more than 20 yards away, when suddenly Jack disappeared. When he reached the end of the road, he looked down and saw Jack underneath him climbing for his dear life. Once again, the harp cried out,
"Master! Master!"
And the ogre swung himself down onto the beanstalk, which shook with his weight. Down climbed Jack, and after him followed the ogre. Jack was nearly home when he called out, "Mother! Mother! Bring me an axe!" His mother came rushing out of the house with an axe in her hand. But when she reached the beanstalk, she stood still with fright. For there, she saw the ogre with his legs poking through the clouds. But Jack quickly jumped down, grabbed the axe from his mother, and began to chop away at the beanstalk. He chopped, and he chopped, and he chopped, until the beanstalk was cut in two. The ogre roared as he fell to the ground and broke his crown, and the beanstalk came toppling after. Jack showed his mother the golden harp. With that and the hen that lay golden eggs, Jack and his mother became very rich, and they lived happily ever after. The end.